Right, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, a few more people arriving. Perfect. So again, thank you for joining us for this session. This is, as it says, is about business analysis and process mapping. So it's going to be a fairly interactive session, so it's not going to be death by PowerPoint. You're all going to have to contribute. It's also not going to be a big product demo, which you'll also be very happy about, okay? There we go, right. So the things that we're going to talk about are going to be really practical, proven stuff that you can apply when you get back to the office on Monday, if indeed you're even going back to the office on Monday. So as we said, these events don't happen without all our sponsors. So these are the platinum sponsors. So fantastic that we get their support, but obviously everyone else out there in the corridor and some of the other sponsors. So some research that was done by the Burning Glass Group said that business analysis is the number one skill wanted by employers when they start looking at Salesforce. So I know your jobs as Salesforce admins, and I'm assuming most of you are Salesforce admins, all of you? Okay, pretty much. So I know your job as Salesforce admins is to make, obviously, your companies run better using Salesforce, but this is also about making your skill set, your value in the marketplace, better, because that's what employers want. So you're also building your career on Salesforce. I think I stole that from someone. Anyway. So obviously an admin's goal is about making your company run better, but also trying to make your users more efficient. I think process mapping, this principle of process mapping or business analysis, is helping you understand how you can do that. So before you start jumping into creating objects, creating flows, let's understand what you need to go and do, why those business users need that, rather than the guy coming to your desk or woman going, could you just do that? And you go, yeah, I'm sure I could. Some of the questions is like, why should I be doing that and how does it fit? Or what does it do to the rest of the things we've done? So trying to get some idea of an impact assessment. So the things we're going to talk about, I'm going to show you, are really simple, been used in thousands of companies. Any one of you can do it. And as I said, it can be done on Monday morning when you get back to the office. And there are lots of ways you could do process mapping. You could use whiteboarding. You could use some software, which I'm going to use and show you. Or you could just sketch it out on a whiteboard. At which point you all go, bless you, at which point you all go, I thought he wasn't going to do a product demo. The cool bit about Elements is, number one, it's in the cloud. Number two, it's free for as many users forever. And the third thing is it's integrated into Salesforce, which is why we're going to play with it. Having said that, the things I'm going to show you could equally do using a whiteboard, using Visio, PowerPoint. So you don't have to use Elements. We just happen to think it's a really good idea. So when people think about process, they think about diagrams like that, yes? And that's some complex thing that IT built, which apparently means something to somebody, okay? I've been around the process world for probably 20 years. That still makes me feel quite queasy. That's not what we're going to talk about at all. That may be great for an IT wiring diagram. That's not what you or business users will either understand or engage with, okay? That's probably slightly better. That's a photograph from a government client that I... So they were big diagrams that were printed out on sort of sheets that big, stapled to a wall in a boardroom, and they asked the stakeholders to walk past them and go, will you sign that off, please? So that's genuine. That was some photographs taken from a client. It's like, really? So the challenge we now have is not everyone works in the same office. We can't have this big war room with pictures pasted around the wall. We need to be a lot more interactive. Your users could be probably anywhere in the world. So we need some principles that land well, whether it's IT, whether you're talking to procurement, whether you're talking to your compliance people, whether you're talking to someone who works sort of dealing with customers or someone who's the CEO. So we've actually got something we need that works across all those different audiences. Right? So the question is, how do you take something that looks like that and make it easily understood? And there's a principle that we've used, which is about hierarchical breakdown, sort of a drill-down approach. So I think you can all understand that. That could be, I don't know, a supply chain flow. It could be a flow of the sales process. Okay? If we took that, and then each one of those little corners was a drill down to another diagram below it and another diagram below it, suddenly all the complexity is now hidden. Is this making sense? How many of you had done any hierarchical type mapping? A couple, okay? Good, quite a lot actually. I forgot to say, everything I'm talking about is in a book we wrote, a free ebook. There's a URL. We've got some cards here with some QR codes so you can download the book. So all of you feverishly trying to write notes don't need to worry. Those of you who are feverishly tweeting, please carry on. So the whole concept here of, if I click on one of those, could it drill down to the next level? So suddenly we're now building out a hierarchy. So if I want to know more detail, I can keep on going down and down and down and down. And you can build out pretty big, complex maps of these diagrams. One of our clients from my last company had 10,000 diagrams in their hierarchy. And you're like, that's mad. No, but they are a global bank. They are retail banking, they are investment banking, they are wealth management, and they're highly regulated. So they have to write everything down from dealing with strategy to issuing you a new checkbook. And the regulators will come and look at it and go, show me how you did stuff, and this is how they did it. Or if you think about a big pharmaceutical company, where if you don't get it right, the regulators will come and fine you. So the FDA, who's the Food and Drugs Administration, are evil. Okay? Yes? Okay? They fined the American Red Cross $130 million for misuse of blood plasma. They regularly fine a pharma company over $1 billion a year. And all the pharma companies go, it's our turn for the fine. So this sort of stuff is important if you're highly regulated. I would suggest, though, it's also important if you're trying to configure a Salesforce org. Let's understand what we do before we start writing code, before we start clicking and dragging. Yes? So, very simple modeling approach. Let's not have lots of different shapes, lots of different colors. Trigger, when does something happen? What happens? Who's involved with it? It could be a system or a person. What's the output? If you want to know more detail, drill down on the corner or click on the paper click and attach things. It could be a link to a Salesforce screen or to a video or to a PDF. So that more information. So think of this not just as the process diagram, but it's also the signposting to all that other stuff you've already written. So people can get to it in context. And obviously, you can build out a very simple thing, which is I'm hungry, get bread. We have bread, put it in the toaster, get toast, and so on. But again, think about these. Each one starting with a verb, get bread, put in toaster. It's not kitchen, toaster. We've got things which start with verbs. We've got inputs and outputs. I see lots of process diagrams where the activity is marketing, and there are no lines going in and out, which makes it really difficult to understand what's happening. And it makes it even harder when you start drilling down. Because you want to know when you start and when you finish. A very senior guy at Toyota said, we all know what we do. We all know that bit. We just don't know what the handoffs are between the next people. It all goes wrong in the gaps between the processes. So having a line, but having something on the line is really important. And often you'll find in mapping, you'll have more arguments about what's on the line than you do in the activity, as we're about to discover when we do some live mapping. So the last piece is you can then build this out as a structure. Advertise a cafe, create menu, buy food, serve breakfast, and somewhere underneath serve breakfast must be that diagram called making bread into toast. So you can build these structures out. Still making sense? Nobody's left? Just good news. Well, we've locked the door, so you're not leaving anyway. So let's do this live. We've got six different examples. I'm not going to do all six. We'll do one that we all choose. But I left my dice in Australia, so I can't roll the dice. But I have got, with the power of Google, I have got a dice. So we'll pick one of those. There we go. I'll roll it. Three. So what was three? Burberry. There we go. Right. So let's pretend we all are planning a fashion show for Burberry. Yeah, so we're going to map out how we plan a fashion show for Burberry. You'll need to help me on this, I'm afraid. So, let's go and have a look at. So this is what we're going to aim for. We're going to aim for sort of a process map. That this is obviously a sales one, which is already pre-built, which inside elements is access. Everyone has access to. But we're going to try and end up with sort of a flow. About how we, with some inputs, some outputs, a few links for how we run a fashion show. Okay? Right, so we're going to start with an input and an output. So let's start with the output. What is the end of a fashion show? That's not a rhetorical question, by the way. Sorry?
Final catwalk.
We've got final catwalk. Any other thoughts about the show, end of the show? Sorry, you're not wrong. I'm just trying to get... collect checks. So you can present it to the press. So, okay, so we've already got some different views about when the show ends. It could be when the final catwalk. It could be when all the clothes have made it back to Burberry. It could be when we've got orders. It doesn't matter, but we all need to agree inside our company where we're finishing and also where we're starting. So if we do, if I just take an example there, we'll take your example, which is, what do you say, the final catwalk. So let's just drag a sticky note out, and let's just define that in a bit more detail. So what does that mean? That lights dim. Sort of end of the show. Sorry? I think there's a degree of experience in the room. Excellent. Right, there we go. So when does it start? This is one show we're trying to organize here. So when does it start? When we've got maybe a venue and a date? Venue and a date. Right, so we've now got an input and an output. Can you all see that, by the way? Even at the back? Cool, okay. So we've got an input and an output. So what's the first thing that happens? We've chosen the venue. We know it's going to be this store on this date. We probably also need a budget, don't we? That'd be a good idea. So let's just drag one light box out. So what do we say the first thing is? So what, create some advertising? Create a collection. Oh, I think I need a few more of these, don't I? If I just double click. So create, so we decide on collection. What else? Hire the models. What else? Invite people, that'd be a good idea, wouldn't it be? So we can invite people, presumably, and we also need to invite some VIPs and the press. So we actually need to build a stage. Is that what you're saying? Okay, well, so let's... Yeah, well, I left that little space there because I think we need to plan the event. So we can now connect that to that one. I'm assuming that happens next, and that happens next, and that happens. And there's no such thing as a single piece of paper. I can just make it bigger and bigger and bigger. Right. So we said we're going into the plan event with a venue, a date, and a budget. So presumably we've got some of those actions coming out might be, I know, we've decided on our advertising strategy for this one. Yes? Not that. Advertising strategy. Decide on the collection. So this is collection. Presumably, number of models required. I was going to say number and size, but I think they're all the same size, aren't they? Right, okay. So you're starting to see some of the principles of what we're doing here, yes? Okay. We could stick another line there, another one there. So invite some VIPs. And then we want to, out of any of these, there will be another output, and then presumably we've then got build stage, then we've got run the show, Is that what we call it in show terms? Do you run it, or do you? Okay, well, that's interesting. So let's try and put some of the resources. Do you remember we had those resources that hung off the bottom? So if I right mouse click and say add resource, so we think that's a show manager. So we haven't got one of those, so we'll add that. And was it maybe some contractors build us the stage? So when we got those, no. Okay. Make this a bit bigger so you can actually see what I'm doing here. So you can start to see we're now getting a little bit more information. We're getting who's responsible for it, what was the input, what were the output. So we're now getting a bit more structure, as in not just here's a list of things I want you to go and do. So if we go back to, let's say over here, we're inviting some VIPs. So maybe we've got the VIP list. And coming out of it, we've got some, acceptances for inviting VIPs. So if I then took any of the same with the inviting people, we've got some acceptances, and we've got some sort of mailing list, and we might say who's going to run that. You want show manager again? There we go. And then let's say we use a system. So we call it, so it's Pardot maybe. Just plucking a name out of the air. And that's a system rather than a person. So we'll call it system. So there's no reason why we shouldn't have a couple of things on there. So suddenly we're starting to, if we want to do some reporting on, okay, what's the show manager's responsibilities? Which systems are used? So again, this is more than just a pretty picture. We should be building in a way where we can start to do a little bit of impact analysis or start to think about how things work. Or if we are reorganizing 6 months later, we understand who's being moved in different places. Still making sense? Fantastic. Right, so let's, if I wanted to go into more detail and say, right, what's the process for inviting people that our marketing team are going to use in Pardot? So I could just say, right mouse click, drill down, new. So what that's doing is it's creating a diagram below there, the next level down, and it's already given me the input, and behind the other end is the output. So that's why it's really important, because now the workshop I'm going to run with marketing, we know when it starts and we know where it finishes. If I didn't have the line, we'd just go, right, this is inviting. So where did we have a mailing list before we started? We've got to go and create a mailing list. We know we're starting with a mailing list. So this idea of structure and scope is really, really important. I think I wrote a blog a while ago that says that the serial killer of all projects is lack of scope control. Okay? Yes? If you don't get done up front, hence spending quite a lot of time working out, okay, when do we think the show's finished? So if you thought it was at the end of the catwalk, and over there you thought it's when we actually had made a return on investment on the show, then we're screwed before we even start, because we haven't even got the right agreement. And I think this stuff makes it really easy because it's graphical. You could lose what the scope is in this big long Word document. So this principle, and if you're building something that's really big, so I'm not suggesting you have to do the whole company, start small. But over time, you may construct something where it is the entire company. So the last time, not this company, but we had a similar product with my last company, it runs the whole of Nestle, runs the whole of AstraZeneca. So there are huge, great process maps. But people don't have to go start at the top, drill down, drill down, drill down, because they'd go to the bit that's relevant to them. So this is the operations manual, ultimately. But from where we're sitting here, this is more thinking about how you configure Salesforce, and that's really where we're starting. Yes? Absolutely. So why don't we do that? So somewhere up here, invite people, right mouse click, add a note. We could say, what are the goals? We want at least 75 attendees. One twos. And then we just attach a little note. Or equally well, we could attach a URL that goes somewhere else, which might go to a dashboard. So this is about how do you collect that stuff together so everyone's got a common picture of it. And then once you've got that, there's no reason why, if you wanted to, we're all going to have a discussion about it. So at least we're all having a discussion about the same thing. Again, not massively complicated concepts. You could do this, you could use another tool if you wanted. But what the principle of this is trying to get people to think about taking a hierarchical mapping approach to it rather than these massive rate flow charts that loses everybody. The other cool bit is that over here, say invite VIP. I happen to know one of my team has been building a different process map with another team about how we do VIPs. So instead of drill down new, I'll just import and I'll drag in a whole bunch of stuff they've already built. So they've been doing the bit called research the customer. So instead of me having to build it, I can click on there and it's dragged in a whole bunch of stuff that someone's already built for me. And they're clearly way better than me, or way better than us, because they've done a lot more work already. So that one there, I went and said drill down and then drag all the stuff in underneath. So it's now a hierarchy underneath there. And if I go down there, zoom to fit. You can see that they've got confirmed customers' details, merged duplicates, and then these things have got more below them. So I've dragged in, they've obviously done a lot more work and there's some more structure there. So this is also quite important as a concept, which is you might have different projects happening and eventually you go, do you know what, this all makes sense to have it as one big thing. So there's no reason why you shouldn't start thinking about merging them all in so that you end up with a bigger picture. My suggestion though is you don't try and say, this is fantastic, I heard this English guy and we should do the whole company. You might want to if you've got executive level support. But you're going to grind yourself into the earth if you try doing that. So it's trying to pick things off that are really manageable. And so picking off an area of this is the sales process we need to fix, or there's an area here we think we should be taking to Lightning. Why don't we just now think about what the benefits of moving to Lightning are, as in re-engineering this area to take into the benefits of some, or exploiting Lightning? Let's just pick off that area and see if we can do that. There are a couple of things. One is that this is, with elements, that you can control who can do stuff. So there are editors and viewers. So you don't want just everybody, we don't want people just changing boxes and lines. But anybody could add a comment, absolutely. And then if you're one of the editors, you get notified of any comments coming through, so it chats alike. But again, the principles of this is you should be trying to control it to those people who are able to edit it. Because the other thing is, this shouldn't just be project documentation. This should be ongoing. So after you've done that piece of work, you should, and things change, we should be going back to this, not starting again. Because otherwise, every time you're starting from a clean sheet. So you need to build it in a way where people are going to look after it. So quick question, who looks after Wikipedia? We all do. Yeah. Well, we don't all of it. We all do the bit we care about. Same principle. If you build this in a way where if I'm responsible for VIPs, this is the way I'm driving my team. So if we want to change the way we work, why wouldn't I make it easy enough to go back and change this? So it's sort of the continuous improvement way of keeping our business up to date. You build this massive, great, complicated thing that no one understands, then no one's going to go back and look at it. Or worse, the consultants did it to you. Apologies for any consultants in the room. But they come and do it, and you're innocent bystanders in all of this. And they leave you with a perfectly configured org, and you've no idea how to change it. So there's no reason. Your consultants have probably done something like this, but they haven't done it thinking with you in mind longer term. If you ask them to do it, they would probably do it, because it's no more difficult than the work they currently do. There's a little section, I think, in the book about dealing with consultants. We try to be as subtle as possible, but it basically says you need to make sure that you control what they are giving you, and it's not just an app, it's also an app and a reasonable way of understanding how the app works. Because this also could be training material. if you've got an app that goes behind this, Salesforce behind this, this is training people on how Salesforce has been configured. So it has a life beyond the project. Okay. Is this all making sense so far? Okay. I've gone through most of the principles that you're going to look at here in terms of simple hierarchical diagrams, a simple modeling construct. You can change the colors. The idea of confirm customer, add to system, update, look. So starting with the verb, making sure every line has got some text on it. There's some very simple principles, which is very easy to go, well, I'll go back, I'll put that on later. And suddenly, you need to do it in the moment when you're actually trying to map it out. So how many of you have done something like this before? Couple? Loads of you. Is it working? Sort of? Sorry?
If you maintain it.
Okay, so what's stopping you maintaining it? Okay. So something stopping it is, like you said, disruption in the business, or not easy enough for everyone to go back and understand, or you didn't get complete buy-in from everybody else in the organization. So part of this is, all of this is a big change management activity, really. So hey, we'll do something interesting. So can everybody cross their arms? Okay, right, perfect. Can you all cross your arms the other way? Okay, how's that feel? It's pretty weird, isn't it? Okay, so this is exactly what you see so in businesses when you ask people to change things, okay? So some people went, yeah, I can do that. I do it, yeah, that feels fine. Other people went, I'm not changing my arms. I'm just doing it the way I always do. Some people went, how did you do it? And everybody went, this feels really uncomfortable. And I do this presentation a lot, so I'm pretty comfortable. It's still a bit iffy, but. And pretty quickly, if I make you cross your arms, you put it back to how it was again. Okay, that's the challenge we have in this, and implementing Salesforce, or moving to Lightning, or getting people to just do little things in a different way, is making it so it's easy enough for them to continually do it enough times so it feels comfortable. And that's the change management challenge we have. It's not a Salesforce issue. It's not a process mapping issue. It's just a human issue. So there's a bit of stick, and hopefully quite a lot of carrot, because if people go, actually, I could find my way through it. There's a bunch of research that says that the happiest people are the most productive, and the happiest people are the people who feel they've made measurable progress each day. So provided you're moving forward, rather than fighting the system or three steps back or all that stuff, that's frustration, kills happiness, and then kills productivity. So all of this stuff, again, thinking about it, making simple, easy to understand, easy to get to, drives up the adoption of both the way you want things to work and therefore the application sitting behind it. Okay? Are we versioning it? Yes. So you can version it by just taking a version of it. Everything I've shown you so far is completely free. One of the Pro has proper versioning, as in multiple archives, the stuff that regulated companies would want. Correct. Correct. So for some companies, that versioning is really important. You could do it just by doing screenshots. We've got a version coming out where you've actually got a slider on the left-hand side, and you can slide it up and down by different versions, and the diagrams change. So this stuff. Is this our second go at it? And we're doing a lot better the second build. This is a lot of things. We've thought about things in a different way. Okay, so conscious of time. That's great, but wouldn't it be nice to see it inside Salesforce? Sorry, inside Lightning, inside Salesforce. So when you can install the free Salesforce package and it will run the whole of this inside Salesforce, which is quite cool, because it's an iframe. But through settings, you can do a couple of other things. You can connect that space to Salesforce. You can make all your users have single sign-on. But then the interesting thing is you could drop any diagram into an object, any custom so there's a custom object called partners. It could be a standard object. I just happened to have done it to a custom object. And sitting in a little Visualforce page, which is three lines of Apex code which we give you, there's a diagram. And it's not a screenshot, it's a live diagram. So if I go and click on that, click on that. And if I could go and find that diagram, which is under there. Sorry, I'm now in the product, not in Salesforce. There's the diagram. There it is in Salesforce. Same thing? Yeah? This is where I get to be Mr. Smarty Pants, because if I just drag something up onto there, like a sticky note, I go back to Salesforce and don't refresh. It's there. So it's self-maintaining. It's just taking stuff straight off using Google Firebase, coming off the server. And if I have edit rights on this diagram, I don't actually have to leave Salesforce. I have got edit rights. So I can get rid of it. And we go back to the diagram it came from. It's not there anymore. So you're building it all off one place. So this is the word we always use, the single source of truth. So build it once, deliver it into the right places. So I know that might be how you want people to fill out opportunities. That might be how you go from a lead to a contact. I don't know what you're going to build, but the idea that you can drop this stuff in as self-maintaining training material with all the links. Sorry.
And then you could add notes to that sticker. You could type
on. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. You can see it on the comments side. If you had edit rights, you could put on the sticky, but certainly the comments you can get to. Absolutely. The sticky is for me as an editor when I'm making changes and so on. So yes, so I could. Okay, so I'm assuming that's stunned silence from people, isn't it? Yeah. So this is not rocket science. This is about trying to get some simple mapping delivered alongside your Salesforce org so you can deliver it to your Salesforce users at no cost. And you might go, that's nuts, Ian, why is there no cost? We have got some add-ons, as we said, for highly regulated. I will show you one thing which is an add-on very quickly. If you think about your Salesforce org in setup, there's you. Somewhere in your setup, there are email templates, there are objects, there are process builders, there's stuff, isn't there, you've built. Okay? Wouldn't it be nice if you could drag all of that out and put it in a hierarchical, in a nested list. Just the things you really want. Not everything, just the things you care about. And then for any particular item, say an email template, say that one there, I'd like to add some notes about why I created this. Absolutely, sir. In fact, why don't I do that? Why don't I go and copy that link, go back to my diagram, and say, right mouse click, add it there. And say, I'm using this to invite VIPs. So what I've now just done is I've taken a link from that email template and said it's used on that process step. So if I change that email template, I know what it's being changed in. But hang on, it's being changed in two other places. So if I change that email template, I know that I'm screwing up those guys and those guys. As opposed to the other approach where you go, I've changed it. Week's gone by, got away with it. Or I delete a field, and what's really going to happen? So you can go one way, which is, where is this used? But you can come the other way, which is, if I'm in a process and I change the process, what things in Salesforce do I need to go and update? So I've changed our inviting our VIP, so I need to change that Visualforce page, those two components, that approval process there, and I know why, because there's some documentation associated with it. Sorry? So that actually is a paid product, and it's $60 per user per month, based on the number of Salesforce admins you've got in your org. But again, we're still adding more and more stuff to that. So reason for showing that is, for admins, if you've got ideas and going, oh, it'd be even cooler if you could put that in, we're open for other stuff. So this is meant to be all the stuff you got, I wish I had. So one of the things we're doing at the moment is, tell me everywhere that if I go to an object, say that, I've got a field there. We're doing some stuff behind the scenes, so tell me everywhere that field's used. Every process builder, every report, every script, the stuff that's really, really hard to do for you as admins. Well, you don't need a diagram. You can get some value out of it without a diagram. But I'd love you to use the diagram stuff, and we've already pre-built some processes. But we're also thinking about, there are some people just going, I just need to get started. It's one of these things which is, this is the fun stuff in Salesforce is like pizza and beer, you build stuff. This is eating your greens, okay, I'm afraid. So we've got to get you started on it. And the question is, if you're not going to do it today, then why is today, tomorrow a better day? So yeah, let's get you started. If you can absolutely link it to a process map, fine. But that means you need to get the process map built at the lowest level. It may only be a couple of levels down, but at least it's starting to make sense of your org. And my suggestion is, what's the catalyst that's going to get you started? Maybe the Lightning upgrade. Okay. Think about what your improved operational process will look like exploiting just an area of Lightning. And at the same time, just start doing a bit of documentation as you go along. And over time, oddly enough, you'll find you've got more and more and more. But as I said, there are lots of other things that people are coming to us with ideas. Oh, couldn't you? We haven't done very much around user management yet. But we've got a team of people thinking about how we do this stuff. So again, I'm massively open to any input on how this stuff can work better. Guys, go and play with it and see what happens. So let me just go back to where we were here. Just think about some principles. Everything I've been talking about is in a book, and there are a bunch of business cards here with some QR codes, so you can get a URL to download the ebook. Again, that's to get into the app if you want to go and use the app. But the principles in the book can be applied no matter what you use. Whiteboard, Visio, PowerPoint, us, whatever. It feels like I've gone through quite a lot, but some key principles which I think are relatively easy to apply. Happy to pick up any questions if you've got them. If you like it and you want to hear it all over again, I'm Charlotte on the April the 27th in Charlotte. I have no idea where it is, but the aeroplane will get me there. Sorry, question. A question, is there a separate pricing for nonprofits? There will be. We're just thinking about how that works. We've only literally just worked out how that pricing works. But it'll probably mirror the discount you would get that Salesforce gives. We're just taking the easy path on all this. It's funny, we've been a Salesforce customer since 2002, my previous company. And it's quite interesting, I was talking to someone in Salesforce, said, oh, I don't like your freemium model because Salesforce doesn't do free. I said, well, it used to. They went, no, it never did. When you were still at high school, and I was, it absolutely did. Force.com licenses were free forever. But I know they're not now. But we're taking that pricing model, which is fine. You guys should get a ton of value out of using the free product, and if the other things are worth it, then you'll upgrade. If not, you won't, and you'll use it, and that's fantastic. Sorry, were there any other questions? Yes. In terms of product, so far, there are some very large companies, but they haven't done very much with it. There are companies like Financial Force who are running their entire business on it. We are already, all the companies who were clients last time, who were the big Fortune 500 companies, were all going, oh, the band's back together, what are they doing? So we've architected it so it would support as a Nestle, a Toyota, an AstraZeneca. Okay, so it's fully multi-tenant type stuff is what we're planning on, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you. Other questions? I'm not sure how you follow that, by the way. Absolutely. The way the product's architected is we've designed it so that consultants or ISVs can work with their customers. So I didn't dwell on it when we were presenting. But you as a user, you create a space. In that space, you invite users and you put content. That space isn't owned by anybody. It's just people collaborate in it. So you could create a space for a customer, put the copy of a map which works for your product in there, invite the customer in, do some work. At the end of the project, say to the customer, that's your space, you can take us out of it, and they just continue with it. So it's designed for just that thing in mind. Financial Force are using it for their internal use at the moment, but they're definitely thinking about how they use it, taking it to customers. Sure. So we've built some PSA models, we've built already that are available. We've built some sales models. Again, we're trying to find some people. We'd love to build the non-profit models, just trying to find some people who know the non-profit process well enough so we can sit down with them and document it. So then everybody's got it. We've built for free the we've built the how you run one of these conferences, how to run a dreaming conference, so that all the conference organizers can all share a common set of, and we're starting to put more stuff on it and attach more stuff, just to make sure those user conferences run better. So we're trying to do some things to sort of to prime the pump, if you will, to try and get stuff going. Okay, so every diagram is a JSON file, so you probably could do a diff. We haven't done one. If you really cared about it and you've got some programmers, we've got a completely open API, knock yourself out. And then give it back to us. We'll put it in the product. But sorry, that's a flippant answer. The answer is you could do it. It's not something that's necessary on the roadmap. You could do it in terms of versioning, but it wouldn't be just a here's a report. We did have it in the last product, actually. Not many people used it, oddly enough, but it doesn't mean it's not valid. But the point about a completely open API, last summer, my son, who's 15 now, for a bit of fun, we went and built a mobile app that accessed all of this as a sort of, you know, Salesforce A. We built Elements A in 2 weeks, just for fun. Some tears, not all mine. I was the customer and he was the programmer, and we didn't quite get that agreed up front. But again, using simple stuff, JavaScript and some CSS, we built an app that just pulled all the pinged stuff off the APIs. Really good fun. So there's some stuff here that if people want to go and build things, then they can. We're making it, building it that way. Yes. So everything you've seen can be reported back out from a process step perspective or the number of links. So you could dump those reports out. Or the other way you could do it, if you're looking at how much you've changed the way you've used Salesforce, then that, you know, that nested list I showed you, you can report out all those links back out into a report and then into an Excel file. You can start to do some comparisons on that. Because the other... Perfect. Yeah. Sure. And I think the other thing is, if you're trying to consolidate orgs, the starting point is, what the hell did we build in how many other orgs? I mean, I've told this story a few times. Again, previous company, again, most of my stories come from the last company because we've only been live 6 months. So large pharmaceutical company out in Japan. How many versions of SAP do you think they have? On my left, number? 28. Any higher on my right here? Can I 28, 30? Can I 30? 1,139. But I'm sure there are examples in, maybe not in the room here, of multiple orgs, and you're trying to work out how to consolidate them. And the starting point is, what on earth have we got? So start with that. First report, but then, and we're thinking about trying to work out how we could do a lot better support for how you could consolidate orgs. In terms of, you've run that report, and now you can compare the two reports and work out, okay, of these five orgs, which one looks like the master? How do we migrate across to them? Because I know that's a big challenge for some of the larger companies out there. So, summary: process mapping is a really good idea. The skills of business analysis are a really good idea from a career perspective, but also from a company perspective. There are some simple techniques which are proven that work. There's an ebook that talks about them. There are some tools out there, ours and others, that you could use. I think it'll make a big difference to the way you configure and run your operations. So thank you very much for spending time with us. Thank you.